ladies and gentlemen, this particular story comes out of Las Vegas, so this is going to be an update. So I want you guys to know this is not the exact same video. This is a slight update because we're going to give you guys a little more information on what you had before, maybe even a little more insight. So if you would, just bear with me. I'm going to try to make some audio adjustments to try to fix this so I can make sure that you guys can hear this and hear it clearly. There was an interview that the mom and boyfriend did in this story of the missing Las Vegas boy. And I'm going to just flat out tell you guys, I believe that the mother and boyfriend are complicit in the disappearance of that boy that you see on my screen right there. Okay? And his name is Amari. Let me see. Let me make sure I get his whole name here. Amari Nicholson. Amari Nicholson is 2 years old. And somebody needs to be an advocate for this boy. We don't know where he's at right now. And we don't even know why he's gone. But what I believe is that the boyfriend gave this boy up, sold this boy, did something, but that's my opinion, and I think the mom knows it. The mom could even be scared of this boyfriend, but I want y'all to look at this interview. Look at this interview and look at how weird this is. And even more people, since we've done this story, have come out and said, you know what, that interview did look really, really weird, okay? Let me give you guys a story real quick. Right now, there is still no sign of the Las Vegas toddler who's missing since last Wednesday. Amari Nicholson, that beautiful baby boy that y'all see right there on my screen, reportedly was handed over to a woman who was claimed to be the boy's aunt by his mother's boyfriend. Hashtag mom's boyfriend. Yes, I believe they're lying. Yes, the live chat is open. Y'all can speak y'all mind. That's what it's for, okay? He's been missing ever since then. For 5 days at least, volunteers have been canvassing the area and giving out flyers. So far, they have nothing. We just want him to come home safely, and that's according to, let me see, Marlisha Everett, who is the little boy's aunt. We're hoping, and matter of fact, I don't even think that's the aunt that this man supposedly gave the kid to. Y'all just got to hear it. So just to let you know, this boyfriend did not have a description of the aunt. Did not. Some random woman came by saying that she was the aunt, and he said, okay, I'll go get his things together, and I'm just going to hand him over to you. And that's all he knows. It's complete BS, and I want you guys to listen at their interview. So at about 3:11 p.m. on May 5th, the boy identified as Amari Nicholson was reported missing in the area of the 3600 block of Paradise Road near Sands Avenue. All hospitals are asked to check their registries for him and notify police. Authorities are asking if any leads or tips might aid in their investigation to make sure and call them. Previous reports of a boy found near a dumpster were unfounded, so that was not him. There are conflicting stories by the family members as well. We heard from the father, Giorgio Hayes, which is spelled J-Y-R-G-I-O. We're going to skip his interview because I think this one between them is a bit more important. So let me give you guys a fair usage. Let's not waste any time. Let's get it. Federal law allows citizens to reproduce, distribute, or exhibit portions of copyrighted motion pictures, videotapes, or video discs under certain circumstances without the authorization of the copyright holder. This is called fair use and is allowed for purposes of criticism, news reporting, teaching, and parody, which doesn't infringe of copyright under 17 U.S.C. 107. And yes, if you guys are posting that in the chat, I do believe this dude might be somewhat of a pimp. I don't know that for a fact. But he just comes off like he's her pimp. Okay, volume is okay. Let's go ahead and get started.
Finger pointing and confusion tonight over the disappearance of a 2-year-old boy. Amari Nicholson has been missing for more than 2 days now.
And tonight we're hearing from the boy's mother and her boyfriend, and they're now saying that someone kidnapped him. Fox News' Joe Viel joining us now with more on what the couple is saying, Joe.
Yeah, that's right. I talked to the couple today. Now, the mother flat out said some of what she's saying may certainly sound confusing to people, but she says someone took her son. She is struggling with a little boy who hasn't come home and wants the public to help find him.
Jeez.
It has been 2.5 days since anyone has heard anything about 2-year-old Amari Nicholson.
Panic mode, freaking out, crying, screaming, just my baby's gone.
Amari's mother, Taylor Nicholson, says she got the news her son was missing on Wednesday while she was in Colorado taking care of her mother who was attacked by a dog. She left Amari with her boyfriend, who considers Amari his son, at the Emerald Suites near the Strip. Now, he says Wednesday, just after 6 a.m., someone knocked on the door.
And it was a woman saying that she was her baby daddy's sister. Mm-hmm. And she said she was there to pick up my stepson.
Terrell Rhodes says he called Amari's mom in Colorado.
I turned around to call her to tell her was this really prearranged? And as I'm doing that, she says she don't need anything for my stepson. They got everything they need for him and basically just took off.
Nicholson says she missed Rhodes' call.
No, I was still asleep, so my phone, I didn't hear the first few calls until it was already too late.
Now, this is where things get a little confusing. The mother tells me she and Rhodes got into an argument about her being away from Vegas and told him someone would be stopping by, but didn't say exactly who and didn't say why they were coming over.
But you didn't know her though, correct? You've never seen her? So did you not know this person you're letting take Amari away?
I mean, from my knowledge, I already was told like someone was gonna stop by, somebody was gonna, but I never knew who. So I still had that in my headset. Somebody was coming by.
But bottom line, Nicholson says she never gave anyone permission to come and pick up Amari. She says Rhodes did not give Amari to the woman. She took him and just wants him back safe.
In this whole story, it sounds confusing. It sounds like we're lying. It sounds like, you know, it's just a big confusion.
Now, I don't want to jump to any conclusions. What I want to do is I want y'all, if y'all are listening to the sound of my voice, do me a favor and click that thumbs up. Share this stream. I want more people to be able to see this, okay? So we have a goal of 400 thumbs up. If we can get there, that would be awesome. That's all I ask. So what I want you guys to do is click that thumbs up. I want y'all to listen. This is going to be the full interview. I'm going to have to pause it from time to time to make sure that we get our volumes correct, because I want to make sure that it's not distorted. But I want y'all to listen to this. We are just getting started. So if you're just coming in, we're just getting started. Listen to this. This is the full interview. This is the full interview. So I want y'all to hear this. Let's get it.
Taylor Nicholson, TaylerNicholson. Okay. And
Terrell, TerrellRA.
Actually, you know what? Let me swap that video out. I put up a better one. Hold on. I put up a better video. Yep, here we go. Sorry about that. Let's listen to this one.
Yeah, go ahead.
Taylor Nicholson, okay. TaylerNicholson.
Okay, and your service?
TaylerRHODES.
Now, how's the last name?
Rhodes.
Rhodes?
RHODES.
Okay. Do you guys both live in Las Vegas then?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Well, I guess just tell me your thoughts. I mean, this is 2 days now without your son. Like, what's going through your mind?
We're devastated and hoping for the best of his safe return, and, you know, just saying our prayers and hoping that God's looking out for him and that he's not in any type of distress or danger. We just want our baby back as soon as possible in the best condition possible.
And your thoughts
going to the like amount that the father's saying that his sister didn't come get him. And if that's really the case, then where's my son?
I mean, it seems to be, I mean, there's different stories floating around out there. I mean, can you just explain to me what you think happened? Or like,
presenting herself as Giorgio's sister, and then the situation process, he's trying to call me to figure out what's going on, and I'm asleep in Colorado, and I wasn't
you think this was?
And I know that that wind is terrible. I wish they didn't have as much wind, if they maybe could have did this in a different location. But I turned this volume up as much as I can. If y'all are having issues listening, I'm sorry, but I really tried to adjust this volume the best I could.
The father's sister who came?
To my knowledge, yes.
And what is her name?
Jasmine Stovall.
Okay, and his sister. And why would she come there?
I'm not sure. They knew the area where we lived, but they never knew the apartment, so they stalked us until they were able to find where the baby was.
And why would she take him?
Because the dad wanted to be the father of the child.
He didn't want to see him getting raised by me and her. He wanted to be in his child's life with the rest of his kids. Apparently, he has a house. He has a stable foundation with four other more children, and the only missing piece was Amar.
Always tried to be in the cordial parent. Has never not allowed him to see him or contact him. I've just always told him, as long as you put in the effort to be in the child's life and show that you're trying to be the father, then, you know, that's fine. But he wasn't doing that. He wouldn't reach out, wouldn't call. It would always just be a message and once in a blue moon. It was never consistent, never like he really wanted to do that. And then we had an argument on Monday, and then he did this on Wednesday.
So you're saying that she came and took him. Has anybody talked to her at this point?
Police talked to her. We've called. They're denying everything. They've been searched, and he's nowhere to be found, so we're just waiting till he shows up somewhere.
So she's saying that
Can y'all hear this? Yeah, as the child. Thank you. She keeps referring to her own son as the child. Let me also give a shout out to Leave It to Bieber in the chat. Much love. Thank you for being here. She said the child.
And take him.
Yes.
Right.
I hope this is loud enough. I'm really trying to turn this up. They sitting there whispering into the mic. Like, why even do an interview if you're not gonna speak up so we can hear you?
So who do you know who went there with him in the first place then?
What do you mean?
With the hotel. Who took Amari to the hotel? Was he?
What hotel?
It wasn't. Weren't they staying at the Emerald Suites?
Yeah. Yes, that's where we live.
That's where you live?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I'm confused.
We live at the Emerald Suites, and nobody knew which apartment or whatever, so they stood outside watching to see where we were.
Okay.
And then that's when they realized, you know, they finally saw Amari and saw him with him, and then that's when they came back in.
So who was at the Emerald Suites that day then?
He was left with Tara.
With you, okay. Okay, that's what I thought. And so, can you just explain, what were you guys doing prior to, or what were you doing in the morning?
Before that occurred, we had just woke up, I had just fed him breakfast, and I was in the room, on my phone at this time, laying down. He's in there playing with his toys, and all of a sudden there's a knock on the door. And it was a woman saying that her baby daddy's sister.
Mm-hmm.
And she says she was there to pick up my stepson.
Uh-huh. And did you know her? Do you know her?
I've never seen any sides of her baby daddy's family. So
you didn't know this woman? So then what happened?
So then I go to proceed to, okay, I'm going to pack him a bag up, pack some of his belongings, and go. And when that happens, I turn around to call her to tell her if this was this really prearranged?
Mm-hmm.
And as I'm doing that, she says she don't need anything for my stepson. They got everything they need for him, and basically just took off.
So you gave? Did she take him then? At
yeah,
that point?
At that, she just basically says she got everything that she needs for him, and just left.
Now, but you didn't know her though, correct? You've never seen her? So did you not know this person you're letting take Amari away?
I mean, from my knowledge, I already was told like someone was going to stop by, somebody was going to but I never knew who. So I still had that in my head, said somebody was coming by.
Who said somebody was going to come by?
That's what I was notified from my girlfriend prior to those days leading up.
Okay, so did you tell him that somebody was going to come by and get him?
I never said anybody was coming to get anybody. It was, but I did say somebody would be by. So with that being planted in his head, he...
That's what I took that as.
She was there for a morning.
So who do you think actually what came to the door and took him away then? Do we even know?
We know, and police are investigating everything and doing the best of what they can to try to reach out to everyone and try to find him wherever he is.
And I'm sorry, just so I'm clear then, who do you think came to the door that day and took him away?
His sister.
His sister, okay. So do you think indeed that was the sister who came that day?
Yes.
To take the, okay. And what did she say to you? I mean, did you talk to her?
I'm the only... words that we had were that she was there to pick up my stepson and that she already had talked to my girlfriend about it. So when I turned around to go pack his bags up, get his few belongings together, She already said it.
If y'all ain't able to hear this clearly, I said ain't. If y'all aren't able to hear this clearly, let me know. But I adjusted the volume as much as I could. This is actually the better volume version. It's just really hard to hear. So basically what they're saying is that she didn't directly say that somebody was coming to pick up her son. What he's saying is that somebody came and knocked on his door, said that they were the aunt, and that he needed to pack up a bag and pick up the kid. First of all, most boyfriends hate the baby daddy. Am I lying? Most boyfriends hate the baby daddy, and most boyfriends aren't going to turn around and be interacting and giving custody of that kid up to any family member, right? That's not usually what happens. So for him to be like, oh, okay, I've never met you, but I know you're the aunt. So I feel, because if you didn't know for sure, why in the hell would you give up the kid? Why would you give up her kid? It ain't even your kid. Which is also why I believe he did it. And because of the fact that it's not his kid, he doesn't have any emotional tie. He probably hates the baby daddy. He probably think the dude is quote unquote lame, right? He think the dude is lame. He think the kid came from a lame. He don't want the kid. He just wants the woman. That's it. This sounds like a pimp and hoe situation, and that they're trying to come up with this cockamamie story so that they can get this kid out of their life. They don't know nothing. They don't know what happened, and they can move on with their little happy pimp and hoe life. Am I right or am I wrong? That's what it sounds like.
She didn't need anything. They had everything for him, and...
So you didn't even give him all of his things and stuff then, correct?
She didn't take anything.
She didn't take anything from you guys, okay. So now, did you okay the sister to come and get him?
No, his family never knew where we lived. They knew the area, but not the apartment number.
Bingo, right there. First thing she said. She said, we did not make an agreement with them, and... They didn't know where we were living. Should both of them not be in jail with no bond for that statement alone? If the police don't arrest them on that statement alone, then I don't know what we're doing here. You got the link. Actually, do me a favor, Elissa Deed, send it to my inbox on Facebook, if you would, please. I was going to say post it in the chat, but let's not post it in the chat. I don't want to give her, thank you. This sounds exactly like the Jackie and Trizelle case. It sounds the exact same. They both came out with these wild, stupid stories. The next thing I think is going to happen is I think a GoFundMe is going to pop up. What do y'all want to bet? They're going to talk about they need lawyer fees. They need help finding the kid. And we need $150 million GoFundMe to help us out. to help us find the kid that our body language is telling us we don't care about, and her arms behind her back, and she looking down. Girls like her look down because that's what the hoes do to pimps. They don't look them directly in the eye. They don't look other men directly in the eye. They look down. They be looking everywhere except for direct eye contact. Or maybe I'm just speaking out my behind right now. Maybe I don't know what I'm talking about.
I never spoke to anyone giving the okay for anyone to come and take him or have him or anything. They just showed up uninvited.
Okay. So you never told him that she was coming?
No.
But did you tell him somebody was coming?
Yes.
So she said she didn't tell her boyfriend that the aunt was coming, but she said somebody is. Let's back that up. Let me let y'all hear that again.
The only words that we had were that she was there to pick up my stepson, and that she already had to talk to my girlfriend about it. So when I turned around to go pack his bags up, get his few belongings together,
mm-hmm.
She already said that she didn't need anything. They had everything for him, and
so you, you didn't even give him all his things and stuff then, correct?
She didn't take anything.
She didn't take anything from you guys, okay. So now, did you...
I want y'all to listen when she starts talking right here. Listen to what she has to say.
You okay the sister to come and get him?
No. His family never knew where we lived.
His family never knew where we lived.
They knew the area, but not the apartment number.
They knew the area, but not where they lived. I'm going to back that up. I'm going to let y'all hear it again.
You didn't even give him all his things and stuff then, correct?
She didn't take anything.
She didn't take anything from you guys, okay. So now, did you okay the sister to come and get him?
No. His family never knew where we lived. They knew the area, but not the apartment number. And I never spoke to anyone giving the okay for anyone to come and take him or have him or anything.
So, here is the key point, and this is why I don't like the police and investigators dragging their feet. Thank you. You just asked it in the chat. So how did they find him then? How do you find, like, in the area where they live? They live in Las Vegas. Out of all the homes, all the hotels, all the places that are out there, if they didn't know exactly where they lived at, how did they find where they live at? Huh? Let me ask you this. If I told you guys I lived in Stockton, California, let's just say if I said the north side of Stockton, California, would y'all be able to find where I live at just based on that alone? And there's a lot of people that actually know my face and know who I am. I'm not so sure if people know their face and know who they are. How would they just be able to find them, come to a city and just find the house or hotel that they're staying at? How is that even possible? When you call a hotel, most hotels won't even tell you what room number a person is staying in, even if you get the right hotel. Am I lying? I'll say that again. If I told y'all I was staying at the Holiday Inn, you could call the Holiday Inn and tell them, we're looking for Jay, for DJ Just Jay. What room number is he in? And they won't even tell you. Out of 300, 400, 500, 600 rooms, they're still not going to tell you which one I'm in, which still means you wouldn't know what floor I'm on or what room I'm in. How would you find me? I don't know if y'all remember that part in the movie The Departed where the dude gave Leonardo DiCaprio the wrong address. He numerically gave him the wrong address, but when the thugs and goons showed up that murdered that police officer, he ended up at the right address, which means he was lying. And I believe that they're lying.
They just showed up uninvited.
Okay. So you never told him that she was coming? That,
no.
But did you tell him somebody was coming?
Yes.
But did you tell him who was coming?
No.
No. So you, did you know exactly who was coming? You didn't know? Okay.
When she arrived, that's first thought I had in my head was, oh, so this was the someone, I guess, that was coming.
Okay. And sorry, just so I'm clear, I'm sorry I keep asking redundant questions, but so are you saying that...
Notice how both of them keep looking everywhere except for the people who are talking to them.
The sister never had permission to come and get him. She just came and took him. Okay. And have you talked to her lately? So I think you just told me that.
No, I haven't spoken to him or his family in a year and a half.
That is an arrestable offense. To Lee Hellinger and all my advocates out there, shout out to you, by the way. Let me ask y'all a question. She just said that she had not talked to his side of the family, the family members, in a year and a half. Why in a year and a half, all of a sudden, it's okay, somebody's coming to come pick up my son? Does that make any sense at all? I'm a rewind it by a few seconds and let y'all hear it again. She said, I have not talked to his side of the family in a year and a half. But all of a sudden, there's somebody coming to pick up the kid. That don't make any sense. You can't be that level of dumb.
To come and get him. She just came and took him. Okay.
Right here, listen to this part. How long have you not talked to the side, to the dad's side of the family? Here we go. Here it is.
And have you talked to her lately? So I think you just told me that.
No, I haven't spoken to him or his family in a year and a half.
In a year and a half.
Her lately? So I think you just told me that.
No, I haven't spoken to him or his family in a year and a half.
To him and his family in a year and a half. So that also means the dad hasn't seen his son in a year and a half, right?
Her lately, so I think you just told me that.
No, I haven't spoken to him or his family in a year and a half. That was the first time that Giorgio went to prison 3 years ago for abusing me while I was pregnant. And he got released last year around August, and he visited him 2 days while he was in town, and that was the only time Giorgio's ever met and seen Amari.
Okay.
So his family, that was the first time they had seen him, was the one day of the visit. They haven't been to contact me, they haven't showed any emotion towards this. They haven't contacted me to get the story. They haven't contacted me to see where he is.
Mm-hmm.
They're not telling me anything. And then he sends a video into the newscasting, and he's smiling in the video. He's not showing any type of emotion, like as if he's really a concerned parent.
Mm-hmm.
It's like he just wants the publicity from it.
Okay.
So let's break this down for a moment. Let me make sure y'all can hear my volume. Okay, hold on real quick. Let me listen. Okay, and you know what? There should be hotel cameras. Y'all are right about that. Let's think about this for a moment. So she's claiming that the baby dad went to jail for abusing her. Now, I'm going to tell y'all, the baby dad did seem a little bit off in his interview. He seemed really weird. But it's funny how we keep wanting to make it seem like these mothers are the victims, right? But if we're going to believe what she said and that the dad went to jail, he just got out of jail, then that means she dated two thugs and put her children around two thugs. Am I right or wrong? Am I wrong? Two thugs. On top of that, what mother in her right mind that has any common sense, if she got abused by the baby dad, like she said, would turn around and let her son be around this man that shouldn't have been able to be around her legally, because number one, she was a victim in a case that he got arrested on and did jail time over. And number two, that would present a danger to that child, would it not? Even that doesn't make any sense. That's a bad judgment. That's a bad call. But on top of that, if you haven't talked to this man since you had this kid, why would you turn around and just let a random family member that you haven't been spending any time around, boyfriend didn't know anything about, allegedly, but somebody on his side was coming to pick up this kid? And as a mother, let me ask the mother. Let me ask the women out there. I know we got some good women. If you're a good mother or a good woman, happy belated Mother's Day to all of you guys. Have a question. How many of you mothers out there would let your son, let your children be around anybody that you don't know? Anybody?
A few times, but we haven't been able to make that arrangement work out yet.
Mm-hmm.
So he has asked to see him before. He has asked for him to come out there. He asked to have him for Christmas, and we had already booked plans before he had asked, so we weren't able to make that happen. So he has tried to, but like I said, he doesn't put in any effort into trying to, be a father in his life. So I'm not going to send my son to a complete stranger when, I've been through that, and I'm mm-hmm. trying to give my son the best life that he can and not have to go through the things that I did as in my childhood. So I'm telling him, be more involved, FaceTime more so he can recognize you, so he can get an mm-hmm. idea who you are. And he never wants to do that. He expects everyone to do what he says on his time.
Let me back up just for a second. So when they came over, you said you called her, right? And did you didn't talk to him right away?
No, I was still asleep. So my phone, I didn't hear the first few calls until it was already too late.
And when was it, how long was it when she came and took Amari till you actually finally talked to her?
It wasn't that long, probably like a minute.
Oh, just quick
so
then. Okay.
She answered the phone.
And then what did you do after she left with him?
I went running around the complex, trying to search for any type of whereabouts or if I see anything.
So what did, so when you find?
So notice he did not give a description of the person who picked up the kid. The mom did not give a description of who she thought was supposed to pick up the kid, and there was no description of a vehicle. He gave us zero information about the person who picked up the kid. Not a license plate, not a car, not an SUV. Was she black? Was she white? Was they Mexican? Was they Chinese? What do they know? They're not giving us anything. That's where I would have stopped this whole thing. You would have given me something. If I interview you, you're going to give me something. Give me an age. Give me a range. Give me a hair color. What pants were they wearing? What shirt? What did their shirt say? Something. There's no way I would have let this ride.
I finally did get a hold of her. What did you tell her?
I asked her, was anybody supposed to come get him? Was that who she was talking about when she said someone's going to be bought?
And what did you say?
I was in panic mode and I told him no.
Okay, so now you're thinking, okay, I was not supposed to probably do that or whatever the case. And then, so you started running around, looking around. Can you tell me more about that?
There's nothing. I was running around, found nothing, seen nothing. They were already gone.
He never handed the baby off to anybody. She took him.
So there was no reason to look. Now, when did you call police? And what did they tell you?
They came out and it was a misunderstanding, said it was a civil matter and stopped the pursuit of a missing child. And so I arrived into town at 3 and plane landed at 2:30. So I made it home around 3 and that's when they started the actual investigation.
So when did you leave to go to Colorado?
I left on Friday.
About what time?
About 4.
4. Did you fly or drive?
Flew.
And what time did the plane leave-ish?
350. And what airline was it?
Frontier.
Frontier, okay.
So now he's asking vital questions. Notice how he's asking, what time did your flight leave? What type of airplane it was? Why didn't you ask the boyfriend what type of car that they drove in? What did they pull up in? What did they look like? How tall were they? Were they big? Were they small? Were they fat? Were they short? Ugly? What skin color? Like, what did you tell them? Gray hair, no hair, had a wig on? You're not asking the vital questions. This is why I would be good in this type of industry. They're asking all the wrong questions. I'm not about to waste my time and sit there and let you talk to me for 20 minutes and you not give me exactly what I need.
And tell me again why you were in Colorado.
My mom got attacked by a dog and the dog ate her ligaments, chewed her food, her foot up, and she needed surgery for, she was in surgery for 2 hours and got over 60 stitches in her foot.
Okay.
And so she's crippled on a scooter, can't walk, can't do anything. So I went out there to help take care of her.
And so you got there on Friday, correct? Correct. At what time did you get in? I'm sorry.
I got in around 5 or 6.
5 or 6, okay. And then you stayed there Friday, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, right?
Yeah, Wednesday's when I came back out here.
And what time did the plane leave on Wednesday and get back here?
It left at 1:30 and it got here at 2:30.
2:30, it was at Frontier?
Yes.
Again? Okay. And I mean, what were you doing all this time after he told you this? I mean, were you just freaking out or what?
Panic,
were you?
Mode, freaking out, crying, screaming, just my baby.
When you're doing an interview like this, you never give somebody a feeling that they can use and they can say, yeah, I was freaking out. He said, were you freaking out? Yeah, I was freaking out. You can just simply say, how were you feeling? Let them give the information. This is how we got Takeisha Williams arrested in Stockton, California. Y'all remember that? Billy Simone Williams. And shout out to the family out there. I still keep in contact with them. We still got a lot of case left to go in that situation to get a conviction. But you let them give you the information. That's why I didn't do a whole lot of talking in that interview. I just let her talk. But you don't volunteer feelings when you're interviewing somebody over a crime.
And he's gone.
Yeah.
And I'm hundreds of miles away and I can't go out and look for him. So I'm rushing, driving to the airport. My mom lives in the country, so it's a 2.5 hour drive to the airport. So I'm speeding through all these little hick towns trying to hurry up to get to the airport because my baby's missing.
Yeah.
And I need to hurry up and get home.
Yeah. And what would you say to Amari? I mean, she's out there watching and it's TV or the sister's watching or whoever's, what would you say to him?
If anybody got him, bring him back.
If anybody got him, bring him back. Boy, if I was interviewing this dude, I might have punched him right in the face. My temper, I don't know if y'all notice, I've been working on this for years. My temper is actually really bad. I've been working on it to try to be nice and calm. That's why whenever people watch me do interviews and they're like, wow, Jay, you were really calm. I'm like, yeah, I'm trying to be a better person. Try my best. I cannot stand for people to abuse children. That is my absolute biggest pet peeve. I can't stand for people to badmouth their children. Oh yeah, my child is bad. I can't stand that. I can't stand for people to spank their children. I can't stand for people to be nonchalant when you're talking about a child is missing. He asked you, well, what would you say?
If anybody got him, bring him back, I guess.
I would have punched that fool right in the mouth.
Watching or whoever's, what would you say to them?
Look at this. Look at how emotionless they are. Look at this.
If anybody got him, bring him back.
If anybody got him, bring him back.
If anybody know anything, let us know.
Mommy and daddy loves him, and we hope that he's okay and playing.
I want y'all to think about this. I don't need, do y'all want to listen to the rest of this? Because I'm about to cut it off. It's too long. and I'm getting really upset. This is their plea to the world for help. This is how they responded. They said, hey, this baby is missing, this child, this defenseless, this child who can't speak for themselves nor defend themselves is at someone's mercy. Here's your opportunity. Plead your case to the world. And here's what they said.
Watching or whoever's, what would you say to them?
If anybody got them, bring them back. Anybody know anything, let us know.
Mommy and daddy loves him, and we hope that he's okay, and playing, happy, and we're gonna bring him home soon.
That was their plea to the world. Man, we got people wanting to fight the police, but we won't have people trying to fight people like this who just don't give a crap about children, their own children. We got people that want to fight the president, but we won't have people that fight parents who abuse, misuse, lie, kill, and murder their children. Interesting. And he turned his whole entire back. Look at that.
I mean, I can't imagine. I mean,
he turned his whole back. He turned his entire back on the camera.
It just must be to not have the little boy. I mean, anybody who has.
I would have punched him right in the back of his head. I would not have been able to hold myself. The camera zoomed into the back of his head.
As a child, it would just be going, what the heck?
It's you know? Sickening. He's a little mini human. He's two. He's defenseless and has no say so. He can't defend himself. He can't.
The cameraman zoomed into the back of his head. Come on.
You know, say I'm done here and I'm coming home. He can't walk. He doesn't know anything.
Yeah.
And to do this to a child is disgusting. When in reality, all you needed was communication.
And I know that a lot of people are, there's a lot of things being said. There's probably some rumors floating around. There's all probably kinds of crazy talk happening. You know, people might start pointing a finger at your boyfriend or maybe even you. I mean, what would you say if that starts to happen? What would your response be to that?
It's inaccurate. It's a bunch of strangers just reading comments and not understanding the situation, not understanding the background, and just trying to put their two cents into it when it's all inaccurate. All this negative, hateful energy of pointing fingers at me and him can't be put into trying to find our baby and bring him home. Instead of causing more drama. I mean, we're hurting enough. We're all distraught over this. We're a complete mess breaking down. And reading all these things and seeing all these hateful things is not helping the situation at all. If we knew where our son was, we would bring him home.
Is there anybody in the family pointing the finger at you at this point? Have you heard anybody talking bad about you?
This side of the family, of course. We've never had the best relationship, even when me and baby daddy was together. His mm-hmm. family didn't like me because I was white and didn't approve of our relationship. And so,
how many of y'all believe that? They didn't like me because I was white. Maybe because you're stupid. Is that possible? I'm just asking. Is that a possibility? Matter of fact, do y'all want me to keep playing this video or cut it off? She's still going to sit there and talk while her boyfriend walks smooth off like a smooth criminal on some Michael Jackson stuff. Walk straight off the camera. Maybe they didn't like you because you were stupid. Is that not a possibility, dummy? I don't think it has anything to do with the fact that she's white. I think she pulled the race card. Isn't that something? Nobody dislikes a good white person, but we do hate trailer trash. We do hate white trash, right? We hate thugs, we hate criminals, we hate hoodlums, we hate gangbangers, we hate terrorists, right? We hate people who commit crimes. We hate robbers, we hate rapists, we hate pedophiles, we hate hebophiles. Huh? We hate murdering, lying mothers and boyfriends. I believe that the majority of people in our society in America got way more sense than that to just hate somebody just because of their skin color. Sorry, that just ain't reality. If people believe that, then they need to be slapped in the face. They're stupid. So y'all said go ahead and cut it off, because there's a lot more. A hebophile. Ask Lee. Lee Hellinger, let him know what that is in the chat. A hebophile. Because too many people confuse the word pedophile with hebophile. I think we learned something today. Look it up. Hebophile. Pedo, hebo. Hebophile. P-H-I-L-E. Hebophile. Almost the same way that you spell pedophile. Look it up and see what it means. Because too many times when somebody rapes or takes advantage of a 14, 15, 16, 17 year old, somebody who's legally underage, they think that's a pedophile, and that's not a pedophile. A pedophile is someone who is prepubescent. A hebophile is the in-between. I think, matter of fact, I know Tommy was the first person I heard that conversation come from, so shout out to him. But there is a difference. Thank you. Jennifer spelled it correctly. Hebophile. That's why Lee was giving me a shout out when I used it in that show, I don't know, maybe a month or two ago. And she was like, damn, I didn't know Jay knew the difference, because most people don't actually know that there is a difference. But there is definitely a difference.
It's always been bad, you know, if you didn't hurry up and answer. So, influence.
I do it. I didn't take anybody. I have nothing to do with that.
Disgusting, because Amari doesn't know anybody. You know, he's distraught. He's in a house full of people that he doesn't know who they are, and he doesn't know where his mommy and daddy are. And
so now people can't say that we don't learn something on my show. So we learned something here. Let me go ahead and cut this off. Matter of fact, I actually have another YouTube channel, and it's called the AFC Podcast Plus. The AFC Podcast Plus, and I posted that whole video on there with the better audio. So if you want to watch the rest of that, it's a whole nother 10 minutes. I can't stand to listen to that woman's voice any longer. Let me go ahead and close out by saying this. To me, in my humble opinion, the boyfriend comes off like a pimp. Everything about his body language, when they say it's not on you, it's in you, his body language comes off pimpish. Her body language comes off as hoish. What I mean that, in a scared, in a following type of demeanor, eyes looking down, cowering towards authority, rather embracing it, following, even at your own detriment, even at your children's detriment. Lying for your man, even though it might cost you as well. Sacrificing your children, sacrificing your body. For what? Then she had the nerve to want to blame it on, it's because I'm white, that's why nobody likes me. No, people don't like you, ma'am, because you literally went to see your mother, who had a little bite mark on her foot from a chihuahua. Mama got her mother, grown adult, who was a grandmother technically. Her little chihuahua bit her on the side of the foot, so she had to emergency fly out to go see her grandmother without her son. Let me say that again. Without her son. Let me say that again. Left her son behind in the possession of her boyfriend to go take care of her mother, who was supposedly going to have surgery from a dog bite mark, left her son, then claims that somebody contacted her boyfriend saying, hey, I'm the aunt, I'm coming to get this kid. And he said, alright, it's on and cracking, I'll get a bag prepared. So when they showed up, even though they didn't know the address, they didn't know where they lived, they just showed up. They had no idea exactly where they stayed. They just showed up. And they happened to show up at the right place. He said, use the auntie. Alright, here you go. Here's the boy. Hold on. Let me go get a bag real quick. Let me fill up the bag. Alright, y'all have a nice day. And I guess he did this all with his eyes closed, because I guess he didn't see how tall this person was, how much this person weighed, what they had on, did they have a graphic on their t-shirt, like were they black, were they white, were they old, were they young, what car did they drive, what SUV did they drive, did they drive up there in a tank, did they come flying in like Superman? You didn't tell us anything. Then you allegedly called the mother and said, hey, the auntie said that she came to pick up the son. And then the mom was like, I didn't say nobody was supposed to come pick him up. Oh my gosh, I guess I better get on a plane and come out there. And he was like, I guess you need to come down here and come check this out. I'll call the police and we'll figure it out. So he said he hung up. He said shortly thereafter, he went around the neighborhood to go look for the boy. Well, if they drove in a car, why would you drive around? Why would you walk around? He said walk. Why would you walk around where you lived at to see if you could find what? Was it a car? Did they walk? You didn't specify. Too many holes in the story. If you ask me, both of them should be locked up for that interview alone, and for police not to be able to at least lock them up for that for negligence is beyond me. We are the AFC and we advocate for children first, and I believe, and we're just going to hope that this baby boy is still alive. I think he sold this kid for money, and I don't understand why people would turn around and try to murder this kid. So we're going to put a prayer hands up in the chat, and we're going to hope and pray that Amari Nicholson is safe and can come back, be delivered to his parents, and he can grow up and become something great. And we can move past this. Regardless of that, mom and boyfriend need jail time. They're going to definitely get hell time afterwards. That's for damn sure. Satan got a special place in hell for both of these two idiots. I'm DJ Just Jay. We're the AFC and we advocate for children first. We'll see you guys on the next update, where hopefully we'll be here to deliver you guys some positive news and a good update. Thank you.